Hey YouTube, Steve from Spark Agile, and this is the Agile Gardener. This channel is all about practical ways of improving your agile, lean, and flow delivery. So if that's your thing, keep watching and I will tell you the first thing to do to find out where your delivery forecasts are going wrong. I've done a number of videos on how to use cycle time, percentiles, and Monte Carlo simulation so that you never have to estimate work again or go through the evil activities surrounding estimation, wasting yours and everyone else's time. The links to those videos are in the description below. But while this is great, what happens when you calculate all of this but the resulting data and forecast you see simply isn't good enough? Well, firstly, congratulations. You now at least know that there is a problem, but where do you start? The answer to that is flow efficiency, and that's what I'm talking about today. So, what is flow efficiency? Well, before I get into that, if you agree that estimation is evil, which it is, and that tracking cycle time to make forecasts for single items is the way forward, it definitely is, then controlling the factors that affect cycle time should be high priority for you. These factors can be broken down into two basic parts, active time and inactive time. Active time is the time you spend actually working on a story. Inactive time is everything else. So we want to minimize inactive time and maximize active time. Flow efficiency is a simple calculation of these two variables, which you can see on screen now. Flow efficiency equals active time divided by cycle time. But how do you get this data? Well, in my last video on aging work in progress charts, link on screen now, you might remember that I said it was really important once you've actually started a story to put it into your blocked on hold workflow state whenever you're not actually working on it. And this is how you will get your active time data. So in this example from Jira, you can see the workflow states to do, blocked on hold, in progress, in test, and done. We're going to exclude to do, because when a story is in to do, we're not actually working on it. It's basically queued, ready to pick up when we have capacity. We'll also exclude any time a story spends in blocked on hold, because that's also inactive time. And we also exclude done, because when a story goes into done, we're not working on it because it's finished. So we just need to add up all of the time a story spends in our active workflow states. In this example, that would be in progress and in test. Now the data is automatically getting tracked by whatever Agile tool you're using. You simply need to extract it. If you're using Jira, check out the video on screen now to see how to do it, but the principle is the same no matter what tool you're using. Now, this does mean that everyone on the team must take full responsibility for their stories and move them to the correct state at the right time. If this doesn't happen, then obviously your data will be incorrect. This might seem like a reasonable request, but if you're a Scrum Master, then I'm sure you know just how difficult it is to get the team to do this. What you'll need to do is explain to the team why it benefits them. It's in their own interest and that of the teams to do this. By doing this, they will get the benefit of not being landed with lots of fixed time, fixed scope work, meaning they won't have to work long hours and weekends towards the end of a large piece of work to get it completed. And they'll have less stress and better well-being because of this. Why? Well, because they'll be able to provide accurate forecasts to leadership that really come true, so trust will be built. But it does rely on accurate data, which means they need to update their Agile tool at the right time. You could put this into your team's working agreement. And if you're interested in a team's working agreement, please let me know in the comments below and I'll do a video on what that is and how to create them. And please consider liking and subscribing if you're getting any value from this, as it really does help the channel out and lets me bring you more content. Right, back to flow efficiency. If you've never measured cycle time before, or you're finding that your cycle times are very high, then it's not uncommon to find that your flow efficiency is also low, around the 10% mark. Let's examine that. If it took 10 days to complete a story, that's your cycle time, but the active time, the time you actually spent working on it, was just one day, then that means 9 days were spent where essentially nothing was happening. This is your inactive time. Remember, to calculate your flow efficiency, you divide your active time by your cycle time. In this case, 1/10, which is a flow efficiency of 10%. So where do you think you should focus your effort in this example? Exactly, you need to focus on getting that inactive time down. So let's take this a little bit further. Let's say that your 85th percentile for your process is 20 days, meaning you've got the cycle times and all of your previously completed stories, and you've used something like Excel's percentile function to calculate the 85th percentile. Now, to calculate your flow efficiency for all previously completed stories, simply sum up all of the active time for each story and divide it by the total cycle time for the same stories. In this example here, you can see that the flow efficiency for our process is 10%. A low flow efficiency means we have a lot of inactive time, and a high flow efficiency means we have relatively low inactive time, but of course a lot more active time. If you aggressively go after that inactive time, in our example, and manage to reduce it significantly and end up getting your flow efficiency to 50% while keeping your active time the same, that would mean that your 85th percentile would be 5 days instead of 20. Much, much better. Now, if your flow efficiency is 70%, then a better strategy would be to target the active time spent on stories, since this makes up the majority of the cycle time. Now, flow efficiency doesn't tell you exactly what the problem is, but it points you in the right direction. It's a starting point. The reasons for high or low flow efficiency could be many. For example, your stories are too large, they're too complex, so break them down. Make sure it's been refined prior to taking it into sprint and any dependencies or constraints are known. Or it could be nothing specifically wrong with the story, but you're trying to work on too many things at the same time. So limit your work in progress and reduce your context switching. Start by putting a WIP limit on your in progress column and stick to it, don't ignore it. Or perhaps you have some process issues causing decision latency. Maybe your stakeholders or product owner aren't as engaged as they could be, so try and build better relationships. And obviously, when a story goes into blocked on hold, don't ignore it. Do whatever it takes to get that story back on track. Using an aging chart every day helps give visibility to this, and because it shows your percentiles, it tells you how critical it is. Check out my video on this in the description below. Flow efficiency is a great way to start troubleshooting why your cycle times are too high. And for more tips on how to improve your delivery time, check out the top 5 ways to speed up in my Scrum Supercharged video on screen now. Okay, that's it for this one. Stay humble, and I will see you next time.